As we begin to think about the chemistry of monosaccharides, let's remind ourselves what happens when carbonyls, aldehydes, or ketones are combined with hydroxyl groups. If that hydroxyl group is part of water, we'll do an addition across the carbon-oxygen double bond. We'll add the elements of water across the carbon-oxygen double bond. That carbonyl carbon will transform into a tetrahedral intermediate, and that will then do proton transfer to make what's known as a aldehyde hydrate or aldehyde dihydrate if we're dealing with an aldehyde, or a ketone hydrate or a ketone dihydrate if we're dealing with a ketone. These are also known as gemdiols. Geminal means that the two groups, in this case hydroxyl, are both attached to the same carbon atom. If the hydroxyl group doesn't come from water, but instead if it comes from an alcohol, where one of those hydrogens has been replaced with an R prime group, then we do the transformation. Again, it's the addition of the OH across that carbon-oxygen double bond, ultimately, to make what's known as a hemiacetal. That's a functional group you're absolutely going to want to recognize. What was the carbonyl carbon now has a hydroxyl group and the OR prime group from the alcohol. So we've added the elements of H, OR prime, across what was the carbon-oxygen double bond. This is known as a hemiacetal. You'll recognize it throughout the chemistry of carbohydrates because it's very important. You'll want to get used to spotting it and recognize that it's really a masked form of the carbonyl. Anytime you see a carbon atom that has two oxygens attached to it, that's going to be formally a carbonyl group. And it's found in its hemiacetal form. And the reason that that's so common with carbohydrates is because, remember, they're polyhydroxylated ketones and aldehydes. That means in the same molecule, tethered to the carbonyl group, we have an alcohol that's present. And if we can form 5 or 6-membered rings, well, we can intramolecularly add the elements of that hydroxyl group across the carbon-oxygen double bond. And so what was the carbon-oxygen double bond of the carbonyl, that would be a functional group, that used to be the carbon-oxygen double bond there, we've added the elements. We've added the elements of H and what was the alcohol portion. If we can form a 5 or 6-membered ring, that is what's known as a cyclic hemiacetal. So a hemiacetal up here, and if that happens to be a hydroxyl group delivered intramolecularly, we call it a cyclic hemiacetal. So let's take a look at the case of glucose. If we form a 5-membered ring, we're going to call those furanoses after the parent compound furan. That's a 5-membered ring with 4 carbons and 1 oxygen atoms. We'll call them pyranoses if we form 6-membered rings where there's 1 oxygen and 5 carbon atoms after the parent compound pyran. So here's glucose. We're going to add across the carbon-oxygen double bond. And we're going to add, in the case of the furanose, the four carbon atoms will come from carbon 1, 2, 3, and 4, and then the hydroxyl group will come from that hydroxyl group that's attached to carbon 4. We'll swing that back into carbon atom number 1, and we'll make the ring that way, and there's the structure drawn in the Fischer projection. Atom 2, 3, 4, and 5 don't change their configurations at all. We're going to deal with, in an upcoming webcast, the configuration at carbon 1 because that's somewhat special. But for right now, there is going to be configurations at 2, 3, 4, and 5, and we should be able to draw those in a three-dimensional sense. Again, I would encourage you to make a model. This will be a lot easier to see if you make a model unless you're really good in visualizing these. And with time and practice, you can. And you could transform that cyclic Fischer projection of glucose, the furanose form, into the structure that's seen here. I would encourage you to try to see the relationship between this and the Fischer projection. For example, if you look at carbon atom number 2 and you were to view it in a way where the top of your head is oriented toward carbon 1 and the neck is oriented toward carbon 3, you indeed get the Fischer projection view. On your left-hand side at carbon atom 2, you should see hydrogen. Indeed, that's what glucose has. On the hydroxyl group, the hydroxyl group is on the right-hand side at center 2. And if you were to just move your head around, indeed you would be able to see the different arrangements. What gets tricky, and the way I've drawn it here is important, but it gets tricky at carbon atom number 4 because you kind of have to move your head to a different position. In fact, I've drawn it for you right there. You can see the position where the neck, again, is at the lower carbon atom. That's carbon atom number 5. The vertical, again, V that is necessary in order to call this a Fischer projection view is seen like that at carbon atom number 4. So the 3, 4, 5 with the V at carbon atom number 4 pointing toward the person's eye, the neck at carbon 5, the top of the head at carbon atom 3, that indeed gives what that person sees in their mind's eye as the orientation with the hydroxyl group on the right-hand side at position 4, consistent with the structure that you see there. So I would encourage you to do that. Go ahead and then think about the Pyranose form, where we take the hydroxyl group on carbon atom number 5, swing it around to carbon atom 1 to make the connection that's seen there. And then now drawing this is a little more tricky. Again, I would ask that you go ahead and make a model. I've represented it in one way here. I like this particular representation, but you could have just as well done the way that we did the Furanos, where we put the wedge in the ring, and the way that you would have done that is to have gone ahead and shown the structure where you would be rotating if you want to an alternative view that's similar to the structure above. If you rotate the 5-6 bond into the plane, then this will come out and be in the wedge form like that. As far as the formation of the aldohexoses, you can see from this table that their predominant form is in the 6-membered ring form, the Pyranose form. And so the take-home message is, if we're dealing with the aldohexoses, which are important sugars in biology, they predominantly exist in that 6-membered Pyranose form, that being the most stable, less strain in that 6-membered ring. One other thing to keep in mind now that we've introduced this idea of these cyclic hemiacetals is that there's always a small amount of the carbonyl form that's present. And any chemistry that the carbonyl can do, it will continue to do in these hemiacetals. These cyclic hemiacetals open up, the equilibrium lies highly in the favored form, the Pyranose form is the favored form, but there's a small amount of the aldehyde present, and so chemistry that the aldehyde can do, such as reduction, will still take place, but it'll take place because there's an equilibrium that's always going on, and so the reaction at C1 is the chemistry that's usually associated with carbonyls will still happen at C1 through this equilibrium process.